a number of shows that way. I mean, you know, it seems like years, but it's probably a few weeks. But I do remember there came a point where, like, we played a show at The Cave, which is a local, you know, appropriately named establishment. And Sarah was in, I guess Andy knew Sarah. And I knew Sarah because I played with Dex. You know, I didn't know her very well.
So we had to borrow a guitar amp from somebody to run our vocals through. So we hooked the mic up to a guitar amp to do the vocals. And then my snare drum was... He didn't put a mic on the snare drum, but the club owner who used to babysit for me said it was too loud. So we put a towel over it.
That's what it was.
And I was playing with a towel over my snare drum, and it was still too loud. And so I had to keep, and plus when I hit it, the towel would fall off in the middle of the song.
Starting a recurring pattern
for years. That's what I remember. It was a pretty rocking show. It was a pretty good show. And then Michael and I always loved it because at the end of the gig, like, we were, like, sweating and everything, Michael and I went up the stairs out of the cave up to the street. Anyway, this old man that worked at the Dragon's Garden was sitting up there, and he'd seen the show, and he was smoking a cigarette. Michael and I came out drenched, and he was like, "Hot, number one!" Michael and I was like, the ultimate compliment.
Yes. And Andy was just singing at this point.
Andy was singing, and then I think there was a period where I think he played a little... There's some songs he probably played guitar on. Andy was fucking amazing. Andy was a mind-boggling frontman. He was real confrontational with the audience. Like, really, like, you know, you've seen us now. I don't even speak. You know, for me to say thank you is like this huge deal. Not because I'm not thankful, it's just because I just am uncomfortable speaking. But Andrew did not have that problem, and he was fucking great. He was really amazing. We play shows where he was, like, in a straight jacket, and we play shows in, like, you know, marine towns, and he'd start singing songs from Mary Poppins at him to taunt him. Just like, just really, he was fucking great.
So I thought Sarah was somebody who might like us and might also fit in.
I think she was looking, at that point, she quit Let's Active, and she was looking for the polar opposite experience, and there we were.
Yeah. I guess it changed things dramatically when Sarah drummed in that she had more than
a drum set.
Like, they were having fun, and as I said, I was sort of, I still have this postcard in my bathroom to this day, a photo of the faces, and I jokingly say that those guys made me want to crawl in the van. It looked like they were having a good time, and this was as close as I was going to get to that in my life, so.
And Freddie, I jumped in to the very end. Freddie was never officially part of the band, but he was. We kept going, "Hey, we got this trip coming up, you want to go?" And he'd be, "Yep."
Yeah.
Yeah, you don't start, in those days, it wasn't the whole awareness of, the career and record deals and, you know, I'm sure I wanted all that, but you weren't really worrying it. I think once you get your first record deal, then it's like there's all these, you're just aware of all these new things you can worry about. And then there's no turning back, you know, you just fucking, the list of worries just accumulates.
So there was something, I guess, special before you had all those worries. And
this was, it was that little special time in the beginning where it's just, you're just, you know, you're just getting really fucked up and playing rock and roll. It's great. You know, now you get fucking play around the world, but you got this list of words on your pocket. So, yeah, it was a good time.
When did you start? Did you start recording stuff right away?
Yeah. Well, let me think. Probably as soon as we started doing cover songs, you know, doing all this cover band shit, and but then we started writing our own songs, and our songs were always like, you know, about like Vampirella, and you know, I was way into fucking Vampirella, but they were like, you know, Vampirella, and you know, just kind of vampire songs, you know. A song called Body Bags, which was fucking great. We're in the middle of it, and he would go into this rap. This was like before rap, but he went into this whole rap about, you know, I don't even know. It was like some kind of sick something going on. Those were the kind of things we were writing about. Vampirella, Body Bags. They're all kind of, you know, we were into the Cramps, so that, you know, some of that. And,
you're sort of always trained to be perfect and tight and somewhat rigid and, you know, play what's on the sheet of paper. Well, you know, and there's something to be said for that. And the bands I was in, you know, were sort of always trying to kind of outthink each other, you know. But with Snatches of Pink, it was pretty neat because they, you know, they were just, it was all about the vibe. It was all about like creating a cool vibe, and to them, you know, a lot of that had to do with not over tightening things and over polishing things, and on purpose just letting it just kind of lay, you know, and I didn't have a lot of experience with that kind of approach up to that point, and so I didn't really know how to deal with that at first, other than just, well, let's see how this goes, you know, let's see what they do, and so we would do a vocal take or a solo or something. And my initial thought was like, well, you know, I don't know, maybe we should, you know, redo that last verse, or maybe that solo, you know, is a little something. And they'd go, no, we love it, that's great. And we'd listen back, and you know, I'd realize, you know, actually it's pretty darn cool, you know. It took me a little while to kind of see where their heads were at and approach it differently.
I remember he had this little, was it a Fostex 4-track?
Probably.
Yeah, that's what it was. Right. It was so funny. Yeah. And then bedrooms. That's what they had in the house. Yeah. And we would all stretch into different things. We did actually do
something in the bathroom. I forget what instrument.
I just remember I used to, wherever we record, like, I don't do as much anymore, but I was always throwing up. And most of my memories of recording sessions are like, the memories aren't really the recording, they're of like the room I was in throwing up. Sorry, John.
It's just nerves and unease?
Yeah, that and just, you know, chemistry experiments gone awry. But yeah, a little both.
Now, I've heard about this thing called the Stupid Tape.
Yeah.
How did it get that name?
That sounds like an Andy name. I mean, I'm not sure of that, you know.
Was it kind of a way of maybe not taking yourselves too seriously?
Yeah, well, we had a lot of that going. There were two bands that everyone in the band were fans of, and it was The Replacements, you know, the early Replacements, the Bob, and Jason the Scorchers. Great fucking band. And those were kind of like the two bands that Sarah, Andy, me, were all, you know, we would take a little... We'd take like little band field trips to go see those two bands play. And obviously The Replacements were teaching a big lesson in not taking oneself seriously. And we were into that.
I remember going into School Kids. This must have been 86, 87. And Freddie worked at School Kids. And Freddie was sort of the de facto manager at that time, right? And there was, I just remember walking in there and Michael was behind the counter. So was Andy and Sarah. And Freddie was on the phone having some shouting match with Jefferson. Right. And it was like this huge public, you know, record company executive conference call thing, just gone to shit, you know, just screaming. Michael's yelling into the phone, you tell him this, you tell him that.
It was kind of funny. I mean, when I was a music director at WXYC, which is the college station that I've talked about a couple times, they put out Sending the Clowns, but I can't remember the timing of it, but they released it, but they hadn't sent it to college radio yet. And so the first kind of run-in I had with them kind of in that incarnation was them yelling at me for playing the record before I was supposed to play the record, you know.
Can't believe you would play our song.
Yeah, I can't believe you would play this record. I mean, I haven't even shipped it to college radio. I mean, of course I'd just gone down to School Kids and bought it. I mean, I figured, you know, the radio station should have a copy and be playing that record. But and that you know, definitely the early years of Snatches of Pink were marked by that kind of love-hate relationship with the town. I mean, you know, they were... There was definitely a period of time where they refused to play in Chapel Hill.
This album pissed me off so much. Like, this wasn't supposed to be the cover photo. That was the cover photo. And I'm still so bitter. And the people at the label really liked this photo because I was smiling. But as you know, like, I would never have a picture of me smiling out. So I said, well, I'll tell you what, we can put that picture you like really little and tiny on the back if it'll make you happy. It's okay. And then we got the thing, the boxes showed up, and I pulled it out. It was sabotaged. So that's what I think about when I think about this album. I'm pissed that they fucked up the cover photo.
People that liked our live show didn't quite know what to make of our recordings because they became more tame and more kind of produced, I think, sounding. And then the people that liked the produced sounding stuff would come to our shows, and it was just loud and just totally all over the place. And they were like, what is this? You know, it's different. So there was that. I think that's a conflict there.
I think kind of all rock bands are always, their eternal quest is trying to do an album that's like they sound live, and you know, you never do. Like, you know what I mean? Like, you know, I was the biggest fan of Hanoi Rocks, and live Hanoi Rocks were just fucking ungodly, but, you know, something that, you know, and even the Dolls, for, you know, and John Thunders, but you get in a studio and you just, it's just hard to capture that volume or something.
The reason we come here is so we can personally meet all the people who refuse to sign us.
I was actually at that. South by Southwest is kind of like the music industry's spring break, you know, and it's usually pretty warm and muggy kind of Texas in March. And we were, I was at the, hanging out by the pool, and the next thing I know, Michael and Sarah and Tim Summer come out, and they're all like completely dressed in black. And, you know, it's like everybody else is sweating and they're just sitting there. And,
right.
It was very, it was a kind of quasi-rock star moment for him, yeah.
I think they did have a big sort of, you know, rock and roll presence. No, I mean, I remember the first time seeing him, it was one of the older cradles, but there was the back entrance,
right.
And I walk around the back, and right before they took the stage, I walked by Michael and Andy, who were both puking over the back deck of the thing.
And so none of that, I guess maybe attitude stuff, kind of turned you off when you got involved with Mammoth and signed them? Was any of that stuff a concern?
No, that's what I always liked about it. I mean, you know, I think he has a presence on stage, and the music is really what was always there. You know, I mean, even going all the way back to the very earliest stages, you know, the music was great. And I could put up with them yelling at me for playing the record early, and I could put up with them not playing in town, and I could put up with all that because I really like the music. And that's kind of what it should be about, is the music more than the personality or anything else that might be behind it. And then on stage, they were always good, so.
A lot of these bands, you know, either they start off as parodies or they end up as parodies. I don't know. I don't think Hanoi Rocks ever did that.
No, they got out while the getting was good.
I guess that's what we gotta do, self-destruct.
Did you get any flack for the stuff you said on MTV about your a farce and...
You mean about what the shit that comes out of my mouth?
Yeah.
I'm sure I got flack, yeah, but I'm sure I just had, you know, it just, you know, ignited more shit from my mouth. I mean, you know, if you're in a rock and roll band, rock and roll in the sense of, you know, my heroes, then there's a lot more to it than the music. And I certainly always wore my